Right, so now we're going to talk about 1D supersonic nozzle flow simulation. So here we are considering a quasi-steady flow, that is one-dimensional nozzle flow, and we'll be using McCormack's explicit technique for the numerical solution. Here the governing equations which we'll be considering for this nozzle flow will be of two types, conservative and non-conservative forms. So basically our objective is to study the system of equations and then solve these equations, the governing equations, to arrive at the properties. So the flow field which we are considering here is that the subsonic flow, that is the reservoir side, is connected to the convergent and then the throat at which the Mach number is 1, and then there is a divergent side. So we are considering a steady isentropic flow, and as you can see, the inlet is subsonic and the outlet is supersonic. So let's consider the non-conservative form of the governing equation. So we will be defining what are the equations, what are the initial conditions we need to consider, and the boundary conditions. So I cannot go much depth into it because the derivations and everything will take plenty of time. So the final equation which we arrive here for the non-conservative form is the derivative of the density with respect to time, velocity, and temperature. Here in the non-conservative form, the basic thing which you need to see is all the equations are defined on the primitive variables, that is the final properties which we need to study, the density, velocity, and temperature. So the initial conditions basically are defined as function of equations, and these equations are well calculated, and for the scope of this exercise we just consider this to define our profile. For example, the area, if you see, so this function basically defines the convergent and the divergent profile. So that's just an example of what we use to define the system. Similarly, the boundary conditions, we can assume that density and temperature is 1 at the subsonic flow and supersonic flow. The final temperature, velocity, and density are a function which is extrapolated using the previous two points. Similarly, we will be considering the conservative form of the governing equations. And if you see the final equations, these are the conservative form of equations for continuity, momentum, and energy. Here, if you see that the entire equations are defined as a flux. For one of the flux, if you see that rho into area, so it has a time derivative of a flux, not the primitive variables. This is the basic difference between a conservative and non-conservative form. The final equations are clear here. If we use this equation to straight away arrive at a solution, then it will be very difficult for processing using MATLAB or something, some other program which you want to use. So we break it down, we assume some preliminary functions, we consider the flux vector, we simplify it, we define the terms, and finally we arrive at this equation. Main reason for arriving at equation in terms of only the u variables is because if we use the primitive variables, then there is some instability in the system due to the errors which is calculate for the individual primitive variables. Here if u1, u2, u3 is the defined system, then the errors are reduced and we need not get into the complexity of it. Just assume it that the error gets multiplied when you have more variables in the system. So the initial conditions, again here we're defining more, we're using the Dirichlet method, we're not defining it as constants here, we're using functions. These things are out of scope of this exercise, so let's just assume that the system is defined using these variables and then the functions for them. The boundary conditions we define for density, for the temperature, for the flux vectors u, and at the subsonic the same extrapolation is considered. So the time step is basically, this is a theory of its own. So there is the CFL number, that is the Courant-Friedlich-Lowry equations, which are different for the space derivatives and the time derivatives depending on the diffusivity, everything. So what this basically does is, if the number is defined in such a way that if it is less than 0.5 or less than 1, depending on the case, you arrive at a stable solution. If you go beyond this criteria, then your solution will not converge whatever you do about it. All the other parameters may be right, but if your CFL number you're considering too high or beyond the limit, then you won't get the solution. So these are the formulas which we'll be using. This is the formula for the time step, basically C into dx by A into V, A plus B. So considering C as less than 1 for this case, for this system, and for the purpose of more simplicity, we just assume constant C equals to 0.5 and determine dt, which is the minimum if we calculate using this format all the specific grid points. So basically the algorithm for the McCormack method, it comes off calculating the initial conditions, then the predicted time derivative, updating the solution, corrected time derivative, averaging the time derivatives found, and then finally updating the solution. So this we repeat for the n number of times. To get to the entire algorithm of it, you need to refer to the MATLAB program, which will be the reference, I think. So further, if we solve this using the program, then these are the graphs which are generated for velocity, for temperature, Mach number, density ratio, and the pressure ratio. So these are the profiles. If you see, the grid points start from 0 to 3, that is, we're moving from the convergent side to the divergent side. So these are the profiles which you get for all the properties. And this plot which is there is for both conservative and non-conservative forms. We are solved using both the equations, and we can see that they yield similar results. There is some error in them, but since our range of calculation is pretty big and the error is something 10 power e power minus 4 or something like that, so we can consider it mostly negligible in this case. So this is basically how the simulation works. The iteration, it starts from 1 and it builds up, it keeps on refining the solutions, and after about some 400 or 500 iterations we arrive at steady state, and then the variation seen is pretty less, that is, the solution converges. So then we come to how the property varies with respect to time. In that, the profiles were with respect to the grid points, here we are considering only the time. So we are considering only the throat, and we are calculating the properties at the throat with increasing time. So here, as we discussed, it first has several oscillations, that is the big amplitude oscillations, and then after attaining the steady state about 400 seconds or 400 time steps, it becomes stable. Next comes the grid independence test. So here what we are doing is basically we consider 31 as the grid size for our experiment. But after that, after coming to the solution, we need to check if the solution is depending on the grid size, that if we refine the size, like if we reduce, mostly we will come to a conclusion that the solution should be more accurate and answer should be more towards the exact solution. So to test that, we just increase our grid size. We just increase it to 61 points. That is, the size of the grids are getting reduced, the number of points are increasing. But the solution which we obtain is more or less same to the solution which we earlier obtained. This is similar because the error which we are considering is quite tolerable. So we consider here that the grid points is not affecting much our solution, and the solution which we got at n equals to 31 is basically a grid independent solution. Next, coming to the mass flow variation. So we consider an isentropic flow here, and we consider the mass to be a constant. That is what the exact solution gives. Then the mass flow rate is basically 0.579 as per the analytical solution. So here, using the conservative and the non-conservative form, if you see that the conservative is more stable and is more closer than the non-conservative form. So why the curve is oscillating so much for the non-conservative? It's because here in the equation which we define the primitive variables. Whereas if you see the conservative, we are defining flux as the variables for calculating. That is, the time derivative is form of the flux. If you see U2, and there are terms which involve derivatives of U2. So this basically gives us a better solution. We cannot go into the depth of it, but if we see that if we break down the parameters, then the error increases, and this is a contribution to the variation in non-conservative form of equations. So the steady state mass flow variation is more or less stable for a conservative form. So the additional input which we get from this exercise of considering conservative and non-conservative form is the programming convenience. Since you're going for only one variable, and you need not calculate the flux and the vectors, solution vectors f, u, j, everything, it is very convenient to go for non-conservative form. The equations are much simpler, less complex, and you get to the solution quicker. But the application, when it comes to complex problems, then that is where the conservative has an advantage. Since you're considering the primitive variables, density or pressure, these may have much fluctuations throughout the profile. Like suddenly there could be an increase in the pressure, or there could be a drop in the density. There are several things possible in a domain. But when it comes to the flux, that is the mass flow rate, even if there is some fluctuation in the density or pressure or temperature, the neutralizing variables are present which absorb this, and as a flux, if you see, there is no much variations. So this allows the system to be more stable, because when the fluctuations come, the error calculated, it becomes complex and solution just blows up, and you get non-convergent solutions. So at that case, if you consider conservative, even though its complexity in the programming convenience inconvenience is present, you get a stable solution, a convergent solution. So that's all. Thank you.